FEMA current advocacy chair. She's also on the legislative chair on a state level. Kelly is a graduate from Santa Fe College. Go Saints! It currently works for Solaris Clinical Consulting, and where she oversees the HIM functions for 13 skilled nursing facilities and 4 assisted living facilities. Kelly, I have to tell this little story about Kelly because her little next statement here says strongly enjoys advocacy. This lady, when we asked her to partake, paid for her own ticket to go to DC to pop in on the AHIMA Hill Day and said, I want to be part of advocacy. And here she is. I mean, she really jumped into it and we really appreciate that. So
what she's not telling you is I want to be Jerry when I grow up.
So the other part of what she adds here is that, of course, when she's not working, which I don't think that she's ever not working, she's always on the road, she enjoys cooking and relaxing with her 3 fur kids. So please welcome Kelly Cooper.
So I have a lot of people to thank for this. I did hop on that plane and go to DC. I actually knew nothing about what I was doing. I didn't know anything about AHIMA at the time. I just saw AHIMA and I said, let's go, it'll be fun. And by the end of that, I was on 5 committees. So be careful what you do. So this year, I have the pleasure of being on the legislative committee. I took over for some pretty big shoes to fill in for Tara Lynn Miko. She is one of our editors. She's on advocacy and she's the marketing chair for AHIMA. Denise Fonto is not here today, but I'm also going to speak to advocacy and what we've been up to in advocacy this year, because the 2 committees are pretty much entangled. You can't really have one without the other. And then we've got our student liaison, Andrea Kidd Pringle, and a recent graduate, Philip Wong from UCF, who contributed to our presentation here. So as you can see, we have quite a robust board of people with a lot of experience that look out for all of us and help us find the information that we need. So I want to take a moment and thank each and every one of them for their contributions to advocacy and legislative. So how many of you know what happens when AHIMA goes to Tallahassee for Hill Day? So what we do every year is advocacy and legislative keep an eye on the bills that are being proposed in front of the House and the Senate for the state, as well as the federal activity. We work with the advocacy committee and the FEMA level to keep our eye and our finger on the pulse of what's going on. This year we had to go to Tallahassee early because the legislative session is earlier. It's an election year, so of course they want to get done faster so they can go earn their money and try to run for office. So instead of going in March, we went on the 30th of January, which posed its own challenges because that's a lot faster than normal, and there were a ton of bills and regulations being proposed. So trying to find your way through all of it to find what we were interested in, as well as to keep the legislators aware of what it was we were talking about, was definitely a challenge. What advocacy does is they look to their members, we divide and conquer. Each of us gets a group of legislators that are working on or in committees over the bills that we're talking about. We call them, we email them, we make contact with them to set up meetings. And then we also have a secondary function at Hill Day where we're mentoring students. So this year was just FAMU brought students, but last year Santa Fe was able to bring some students as well, and that's a lot of fun. So again, we familiarize the students with the legislative process. So when we're up there, it's kind of part business, part fun. We do show them the different areas of the legislative buildings and the process that they go through. They do get a little pamphlet that talks about what each of the legislators does, where they're from, what they're over, what committees they're on. And we do also take them up to the 22nd floor so you can see the whole of Tallahassee from the top of the building. This year, the 2 bills were House Bill 793 and Senate Bill 280, and the main focus of these were telehealth. As we know, telehealth is a huge topic, and there has been a lot of work on the VA side at the federal level. And so we were picking up on that at the state level. So one of the things that the bills really do is they focus on increasing that patient engagement. I don't know if you guys know a lot about telehealth, but telehealth's design is really to get healthcare to people who may not be able to get to where the healthcare is. So maybe you live out Stark, but you need a specialist in Gainesville. Telehealth would help you with that. It's getting that access to healthcare for the critical care hospitals as well. So if you're at a critical care hospital and they need an opinion from a specialist who's 2 or 3 or 4 hours away, they can connect, look at your record, do interviews with you via remote software and video times and phone calls to really get an idea of what's going on and provide their expertise and kind of take out that travel piece so you're not wasting time waiting for somebody to get there. It's more cost effective and it improves patients' quality of life, and I think we're going to see a lot of this exploding as well with mobile health, with our wearables. Because as we're starting to collect all this data, we're going to do something with it. Doctors are going to want to do something with it. One of my friends actually has this really neat new insulin pump that he wears, and he just holds a little device up to it, and it tells him how much insulin he needs. No more finger sticks. He just does that. It tells him what he needs. He injects it, checks it again later. And it will, of course, improve healthcare outcomes. It will, of course, also be a nightmare for COVID. The intent of the bills was to establish a framework for providing this care, which we all know is very, very important. One of the things that FAHIMA has definitely been concerned about with telehealth is that it's just going to run wild. How are we going to know who's doing what? Are they having meetings over Skype and talking about, you know, personal health information, the PHI? And anybody who wants can maybe hack in there and have a view and get all that information themselves. Are they sending unencrypted emails with patient information in them without the authority of the patient to do that? So we wanted to make sure that we're having our voice heard, ensuring that the standards are correct, that they comply with protecting patient information, and that they don't throw a monkey wrench in the plan. So again, enhanced access to care, timeliness, patient engagement, and a growing demand and cost savings. The problem that we had was the bills didn't lay out any framework for how anybody got paid for this. Kind of a big problem. And in fact, you should have seen some of the legislators' eyes when we told them that. They kind of didn't realize they had missed that part. So when we were there, this bill was actually in committees while we were there. So the people we were meeting with were actually going back and forth to committee meetings to discuss this bill, which worked out really well for us. It was also, I've been the last couple of years, and I've never seen the legislative aides and the legislators so interested as they were this year. They were taking notes and actually asking questions that made sense instead of going, And so because of our work, and I think because of the information that was provided, both bills died in committee, which means they never actually made it out to be voted on by the House and the Senate. So just so you guys have a little background on that, when a bill is presented, it has to go in front of the House or the Senate, and then it's sent to committees, usually 3, sometimes 4, sometimes more, depending on how bored they are. And our goal was to try to nip it in the bud. So before it comes out of committee, because if it passes through the committees, then it goes to be voted on. And sometimes these committees are sneaky, as we saw last year, where they tried to amend the language to the bill we were talking about last year, but they tried to make it worse, not better. And that's where advocacy and legislative really have to work together, sometimes even up to the hour before we go and sue Tallahassee for Hill Day, to keep an eye on what's going on, who's saying what. And so for Hill Day, there's 2 parts. There's the part of the people that are actually in Tallahassee, and then there's the back home team, which Jerry was part of this year. And what they're doing is monitoring emails for people that need to reschedule their session with us. So maybe we're supposed to go see Ted Yoho's office. Well, he's at the national level, but someone at the local office, and then all of a sudden, oh, I've got this committee meeting that just got rescheduled, and now I need to see you 2 hours later. So Jerry and the other members of the home team let us know that, so that we can readjust. That said, if we don't have a meeting with somebody, we still go in their office. We still meet with their legislative aide. We still give them the documents that we have, and we still try to talk to them. And sometimes those drop-offs turn into meetings. So it can be a little trial by fire, but it's a lot of fun. So here you'll see our current president of FAHIMA, Courtney Simmons. She's in the back, with 2 students from FAMU meeting with one of the legislators. And so when we go up there, everybody that's in a blue shirt has a few students with them that they take along to their meetings. And we try to let the students actually be talking. So we have a meeting in the morning where we talk about, here's what we're doing, here's what we're talking about, here's our position. FAMU's really great, and Santa Fe both have been really great with working with the students ahead of time so they know what we're talking about. They don't just show up and go, oh, what are we doing? This will be fun. Because you have to know what you're talking about, and you have to be able to have that elevator speech for why we feel the way we feel, and why are we even here giving them anything. So it's got that mentor component to it, and that's honestly probably what I like the best, which is hard to say because I really do like talking to the legislators and their staff. Here we go, we've got some more students with Dr. Marjorie McNeil from FAMU. She always brings quite a few students because they're right there, it's very easy for them. And several of the students will actually follow up with the legislators in the weeks after Bill Day and go back and talk to them and find out what's going on. And like I said, it's a bit touristy too, so we go and we look at the House chambers and the Senate chambers. It's kind of a maze. It's a lot of fun because the Senate's in one building, the legislators are in another building, and there's like three buildings in the middle, and there's all these crazy pathways, but you can only get to some of the pathways on the second floor, and if you want lunch, you have to go in the basement, which I didn't know we had basements in Florida. Who knew? And there's only two elevators that go up to the 22nd floor, but they're in a long hallway, and they run with all the other elevators, so you can be waiting a good 30 minutes just to get in the elevator to hope to get up there. So we definitely make an adventure of it. We also go to Facebook and Twitter, which I'm going to go ahead and put on my social media hat here for a minute. If you're not on Facebook and Twitter with us, please get on there. There's a lot of good information that gets shared, and not just from Northeast Bohemia, although I do think we're best. But there is a lot of resources from the other regional associations, from the Florida level. There's talk for you students. There's the scholarships. You will see them posted a lot so you can keep up on the deadlines for applying for the scholarships, the test reimbursement, things like that. But we also do Twitter and Facebook rallies for our Hill Day. Last year was interesting because National Hill Day was on the same day as State Hill Day, so we had a double rally. And in fact, at lunchtime, we were trying to tweet more than each other, so we were in a tweet battle. This year, because it was separate, we were able to kind of focus more on the State Hill Day, and we'll save that. The national stuff for their day. But we post pictures, we connect with the legislators and the senators. We want them to know that we went to their office. We try to get a picture with them and put it on here because here's the proof that they talked to us. And if it's on there and a lot of people are liking it, then a lot of people are going to say, who is this person? Maybe I should learn more about them and maybe I'll vote for them the next time. And we do actually have a senator from the Panhandle area that reserves the room for us. And he took a picture with us, and we were walking with him as he was on his way to committee to vote on the bill we were talking about. So that was kind of interesting.
We also had actually some of the representatives retweet.
Yes, this year we had some retweets, we had some replies, lots of quoting the tweets and thanking us for coming. So it's another way to engage with them that gets them out to some of these younger people like myself who are more on technology than they are with, you know, I get a mail thing, I'm just going to throw it in the garbage, but if I see it online, I might pay 5 more seconds attention to it. So again, some of the pictures of the different things. We do encourage the students to take pictures. We do encourage them to step up and discuss the bills that are there, and we're there to help mentor them and help guide them if they get stuck. The two students I had with me were fabulous. They did really, really well. And it really engaged with the couple of legislative assistants that we got to be with. So I'm kind of hoping we'll see more students next year. So if you know students or you know a college or you're at a college, try to convince them to come on up there because it's a good time. So let me see if I can figure out how to make this play. Do you know how to make it play? So Philip Davis, technical difficulties. I've presented this a couple times, but Philip Davis, I'm going to take a view of what happened at Hill Day. I apologize in advance for the action shots with myself. I didn't know what to film.
Okay.
Truckers Association, from the Future Farmers of America. There were several different, like, hospital organizations that were there with us. So there were a lot of people coming and going. There were even a lot of locally elected officials that had been invited up by the different legislators. So we were kind of having to dodge them while we were going through. The other action shot he got of me there was I was talking to the two students from FAMU about tips for taking their RHIA exam. So when we have those quiet moments like that where we're not dropping off or we're waiting for a meeting, we try to make sure we help them and talk to them about that transition, bridging that gap from being a student to becoming a professional in the field. And that's another really big passion of mine, and that was actually how I first got involved other than going to DC, was I got on with Jerry and bridging the gap. So if you're not a mentor, you might consider being one. And if you are a mentor, you might consider coming to Hill Day because it's another chance to mentor in person. All right, so before I go into my other hat, how many of you know that the legislative committee will answer questions that you have about rules and regulations? You all do now. If you guys come across something sticky and you're not sure what the answer is, email us. You can use this editor, RRG editor, or you can just email legislative@fahima.org, and we will help you out. We just recently put our heads together on a question about whether or not we can restrict the explanation of benefits for a non-custodial parent, because the custodial parent doesn't want that information shared. We've also answered questions about specific record releases. We had a question that came out of a court ruling at the federal level about whether or not incident reports and adverse incident reports were allowed to be released. And we all get together, we put our heads together. I've got some really, really, really amazing people. I mean, look at this list. Really, really amazing people who have a lot of experience and knowledge that put our heads together, we talk it out before we give an official answer. So by the time you get the answer, you've had a well-rounded look at it, and now it becomes knowledge for everybody. So we wear a lot of hats. Our other big thing is the Regulatory Reference Guide, formerly known as the Legislative Manual or something to that effect. I'm so used to calling it the RRG now, I don't even remember what it used to be. It is a lifetime. I talked about this last year, some of you are going to have to hear this again, I'm sorry. You'll probably hear it a lot. It is my baby. And all of these are my subject matter experts. They are not all of my subject matter experts, because we are in the process of adding 3 or 4 more that work in the areas of the chapters that they're responsible for. So for example, Benita Clark covers our hospice records. I cover long-term care and skilled nursing facility records. Kelly McLennan covers everything basically because he's amazing, but he also does HIPAA and some of the legal stuff. And then we have our group of editors. And I love this group of editors because most of them have been on the committee or involved with the committee for years. So the RRG transformed from a paper product to an electronic product in 2015 and 2016. It is now fully electronic. You can download a PDF version of it if you'd like. But we update this quarterly. And if you have subscribed to it, you have been getting the updates. There just haven't been a lot of bells and whistles about it, and we're working on that. But we do check the content at least quarterly, and we are working on updating a lot of the links that change. For example, the Office of Compassionate Use is now the Office of Medical Marijuana, which means all of their links have changed. They also didn't tell anybody that, so we found out by accident. So it's a work in progress. We're always looking for feedback. We are in the process of working on getting a version on Amazon that would be an annual version, so where you wouldn't have the subscription model, but you wouldn't get the quarterly updates as well. The subscription model is really your best bet because you're going to get the freshest content. It's going to be updated every quarter, every chapter. So no more of this 2 years and then we've got to update everything. We are looking at it every quarter and updating it.
What is the cost of that?
We're going to get to that.
Sorry.
One slide.
Sorry. I'm always ahead.
So the cost here is for the member and non-member. There is also a student subscription. It's not on the slide. It's a little bit cheaper. Oh, it's down at the bottom. Just kidding. Terrellyn hid it from me. So really what we're doing here is providing you something that stays relevant moment to moment. So if there's a big change and you've heard about it, we've probably heard about it too, and we're working on getting it incorporated. We just released on March 15th a chapter on LGBT records. Let me tell you, that was fun to put together. That said, there's not a whole lot out there right now, and it's a constantly changing and shifting area, and we are going to keep ahead of it so you guys can keep ahead of it. So we've got some really good information in there, from definitions to the different terms you might encounter when working with those records, to some of the laws and what they do and don't cover at this point. We are also always looking for feedback on chapters, so if there's an area you feel isn't represented, you can always let us know. We'll look into it, see how much we can put together and put it in there. But we have hospice, we've got hospital, we've got the EAPGs, outpatient ambulatory surgery, home health. Throughout the book, we have information on correctional records, so what to do with records for prisoners. We have two subject matter experts that look over that and make sure we're addressing those where need be. And like I said, we just added the transgender and LGBTQ records.
Any thought on borrowing one of the legal textbooks for the student?
We have actually given a subscription to every one of the KHM-approved legislators to look at and provide us feedback on that. It does have an ISBN number now, so you can use it as a textbook for your students. But we did send that out to all of them. I know Julie's got access to it.
Have you considered having a group student break? Do you have 10 students, 20 students?
We could do that. The thing about it is the subscription is tied to an email address. So if you had a group of students that were doing it and say they graduated in May, they would still have that access for the year after that, and it wouldn't necessarily be something that the program would continue. So if you guys are interested in that, we can look into it. But the reason it's like this is because it is a calendar year subscription based on the date you subscribe to it.
Okay. So it is electronic?
Yes.
Correct? So you will have a link that you will click on?
Yes. Correct? It's on the FAHIMA website. You go to the FAHIMA website, and it's right there on the resources tab. If you haven't received your instructor version, please let me know. Because we emailed all of the KHM programs in December of last year, and we did not get a response from everybody. So if you didn't see that email and respond, let me know and we'll get you your educator version. But again, we have a couple of different ideas. So we are going to put a full version on Amazon at some point, probably between now and the end of next year, that is going to be a one and done. We're also talking about maybe putting up the individual chapters, so maybe you don't want the whole regulatory reference guide, but you work in home health and you want that chapter. So these are all things we're kind of putting out there and thinking about talking about. Additionally, we're also working on getting those podcasts, and these podcasts are actually going to be video podcasts. They're going to refine the information in a chapter, offer you some guidance from experts in the field, and help you kind of wrap your brain around what's in the chapter, because I don't know if any of you guys have read legal stuff, but it's a little dry.
First of all, kudos to you guys for putting that together. It's awesome. I'm wondering, with those podcasts, if you could include case studies. I know that you had mentioned that. If that is part of it folded in, I know that's huge, but I would think your subject matter experts have those case studies, those real life, that could, you know, bring life to the students as well.
That is a good point. I will add that to my list. And that's what we need you guys for, because you guys are outside, and I don't know if you guys know, but sometimes you can be like, where is my phone? I can't find it. And somebody has to go, it's in your hand. Oh, right.
It's been a lot of really good work.
All the time. I have two phones. It's a good time. Where are my phones? That's what you get when you have a work phone and a personal phone. You lose your phone all the time, and you never know which one. So this is available. There is a preview that talks about the content of the different chapters that's on the FAHIMA website if you want to check it out first. And like I said, it is being updated quarterly. So here's the little link. You can also just go to the FAHIMA website and go to resources, and it's on the page there along with the preview document. But it's a far cry from the paper version. It's a lot different. The links in the book, you can click on the link and go straight to the chapter or the statute or the resource that we've provided. That was part of our goal of making it electronic, because it's fully interactive. So if you want to go and have some bedtime reading and read the statute that that came from, you can click on it and go right to it. Alrighty, so any questions about any of that? Somebody's got to have a question.
I don't see a question, but yeah. Could you back the screen up for just a
second? I certainly can.
Thank you. I don't have a question, but I think about a year ago here through the Rural Health Alliance, they had a demonstration on telehealth. And they had a doctor in North Carolina or South Carolina.
We cannot hear anything.
Sorry, I don't talk to them. So they had a doctor in North Carolina or South Carolina performing a visit to someone in Jacksonville, and he was looking at, the physician was looking at the so-called patient's scalp, and the visual was amazing, what we saw on the screen. It was really neat. So that cost difference, that's just a couple of states. I can't even imagine someone, you know, across the globe, you know, a physician that's renowned could help with, yeah. So that'll be an exciting thing to see in a telehealth. So it was neat to see that you could be involved in the bill.
And we do actually have a chapter on telehealth in the RRG. It's, of course, growing because it's changing all the time. But telehealth is really fabulous. Like I said, I work in long-term care. Our physicians have 5 buildings, 3 hospitals, and maybe their own practice. So getting them to come in the building could be a lot of fun, short of chaining them up and dragging them. So if we can have something like this to where they can assess the patient remotely, so maybe they're at the hospital and they're in between cases, and they can see 5 patients while they're in between cases and just do their little annual review and say, oh, you know, where's my ARNP notes? I can review them, I can talk to the patient. That would save all of us so much time and money and be so much more effective, especially for our people who can't leave the building to go to their physicians. And for the specialists, because a lot of times our patients require specialists, but getting them to the specialist means, you know, an ambulance van, and someone has to go with them, and it can be detrimental to them to even make that appointment. Yeah. So I'm really, really excited about telehealth in my work. I'm just also very concerned because I already have doctors that want to try to text patient information, and now I'm like, here, have a video, it'll be great. Alrighty. Any other questions, comments? Alrighty, well thank you guys. The advocacy and legislative committees are always looking for input and for committee members at the state level and at the regional level. I am advocacy at the regional level. We do advocate. So if you're interested, please get with me and let me know. Thank you.